have a familiar face to both Channel 5 and 5 Star viewers. It's our own Roach Bridgeman. Go on. How are you getting on, Jasmine? You're doing all right there.
I expect good pens.
No.
No good pens, honestly. No. You've got one.
Now, Aaron, last year's documentaries on vigilante Brits, which is about paedophile hunters, and one we discussed on this show several times, One Punch Killers, where he scored acres of coverage in our newspapers, as well as being winning big audiences, both for 5 and our sister channel, 5 Star. Well, tonight sees the start of a new series of hard-hitting programmes under the umbrella When Kids Kill. Six-part series, six programmes. Whose stories are you looking at?
Loads of different stories. There's, I think it's about eight to ten altogether. The first one today is about Sophie Lancaster, who unfortunately was killed in an attack for being a goth. She was walking with her boyfriend.
Yes,
literally walking with her boyfriend through a park in Bacup in Lancashire. Two boys seen her, didn't like how her and her boyfriend were dressed, and literally jumped on them. And
how old were the boys?
About 16 and 15. Yeah.
Ryan Herbert, wasn't it?
Yes, Ryan Herbert. Brendan Harris, yeah.
There were other boys involved as well,
There were, yeah.
Now, Sophie, they were targeted for being goths.
Yes.
But I can remember people saying afterwards whether picking on goths could be considered a hate crime. Do you think such a terrible thing could happen again?
And that's the thing. When I went up there, I spoke to local people in the community, and a lot of people seem to think, with the mentality of how it is up there, that it could happen again, and that's simply because people don't really accept difference. Everyone kind of says that's the same thing. Everyone dresses the same. So if you dare to be different, what happens is you get picked on. Yeah.
Well, Aaron returns tonight to the scene of killing Stubby Lee Park up in Lancashire and asks what motivated the teenage murderers.
I don't understand how this could have been done to two random strangers in a park by a group of young men. Like, it doesn't make any sense to me.
My personal view is it's just feral. I think it's fair to say that when you look at the backgrounds of both Harris and Herbert, they'd had some problematic issues in their lives. That's no excuse, but they had no real role models in their lives.
That still does not eradicate their responsibility, because lots of people have terrible lives and grow up to be amazing, compassionate human beings.
That's the truth. I know Herbert appealed for an early release last year.
Yeah.
Didn't get it, rejected by the judge. Yeah. Do you know why?
I believe because he actually told the truth from the start. He didn't try to perverse the course of justice. He said, yeah, it was me.
Right.
And whereas Brendan did not. So I think he was trying to use the whole argument of, well, he served more time in jail because he, handed himself in kind of, in the first place. But the crime is horrific.
Judge took the view, but he says rightly, he was, although he was upfront about it, he was upfront in a kind of proud way.
Yeah, that's the problem. Yeah, they were literally in court, like, treating it like it was just a day out, like laughing, messing about, and you've got, the victim's family who were also in court.
Yeah, I mean, I know you're probably going to say you've got to watch the programme, but
yeah.
At the end of the investigations you make, can you get a handle on the mindset? I mean, you've explained picking on someone because they're different.
Yeah.
I can see how that happens. The mindset, you turn up to your day in court, you're facing a life sentence, and you think it's a joke?
Yeah.
I mean,
you can never get your head around it. And one thing that I'll say is that even after, doing the filming, doing the show, it still stays with you. It's impossible for you to just shake it off. Some of the things that I've read, seen, and learned about, it's something that still stays with me.
I was surprised to find out, actually, that you're not doing the story of Robert Thompson and John Venables, who are arguably the most famous child killers in this country, killed James Bulger, of course, the toddler, in 1993. Why aren't you looking at them? Is there any reason?
Not a specific reason. I think maybe because of how long ago it was. But we do actually touch on it.
Okay.
Because there's an episode where we deal with anonymity orders and killers who can't be named because of their age, or because the court ruled that it wouldn't be best practice to name them. And we do touch on the fact that, with Venables, they were actually given the opportunity to have a new identity.
Yes.
And then we kind of use that as an understanding for the killers in our show who have been given anonymity. And if it's the right thing to do, do we give young people another chance? And so we did touch on it, but we don't actually have any type of...
I know Jess has got a question about that.
Go on.
And one of the things was they were released after about 7 or 8 years, weren't they, available to
yes.
and Thompson, and the argument was that there was no benefit in keeping them locked up as adults, you know, if they committed the crime as young people. What do you think of that?
You know, that's a massive kind of like conversation and argument that's going on. It's like, you know, do we treat children who committed crimes as you would an adult? Because a child could still have the ability to change. A child